you know, whether it's a game or not is another funny thing, but I call it a no-player game. I read a book called Automata Studies, a whole series of interesting things about automatic machines, through the automaton. In particular, John von Neumann had been interested in colonizing the planets. You see, you can't afford to take humans out to the planets. It's a long way away. You've got to carry more food and everything than the weight of the human by a long way. By the way, you've also got to equip your planet with an atmosphere. And von Neumann's idea was that you first send some machines over. His model was that you're really going to send them to Mars. Now, Mars is called the Red Planet, and that's because it's got a lot of iron ore, basically rust. And so what these machines do is initially, well, a whole lot of stages, but a big important stage is they smelt the iron ore and get iron. And then, they're quite clever machines, they start using this iron ore to build new machines, whose job is to smelt more iron ore and so on. Not only are you doing that, but rust is iron oxide, and so when you separate it into the iron, you get oxygen out of it. And so now you can build up an atmosphere containing oxygen. I don't think he hoped to equip the whole of Mars with such an atmosphere, but maybe you have some kind of shell or dome, and in that dome you can have an atmosphere. And then after a considerable time, when these machines have all been chugging away and making more machines and so on, and smelting more iron and producing more oxygen, you send the guys over, us, you know. Then he realized that you had to have a machine capable of building a copy of itself. And that seems a bit difficult. Maybe in order to build a machine, you need a more complicated machine. And in order to build that more complicated machine, you still need an even more complicated machine. But von Neumann thought, no, maybe that's not so. And he proved it wasn't so. He proved it really, I don't know whether he was aware of this, by copying what's done to us with RNA and DNA. Inside every cell of your body, you've got some RNA molecules. And they contain complete instructions for building another one, a copy of you. I call that the tape. So you have a machine and you put a tape in it and it builds a copy of whatever machine is specified by that tape. And then if you can do that, and it's fairly easy to do that in a way, you can now feed it with a copy of its own tape. And then you can, in that way, you can manage to design a machine and a tape which will build a copy of that machine and copy its own tape, so that it will build a copy of itself. Von Neumann's machine, each square had 29 states. In the game of life, you only have two states, on and off, or live and dead, whatever you want to call them. In von Neumann's, you had 29 states. If you wanted to do something different, to have some other facility, you just added a few more states. In other words, his machine was designed. Now, my life game wasn't designed. I just sort of thought, if you couldn't predict what it did, then probably that's because it was capable of doing anything. For about 18 months of coffee times, and I'm not sure that, you know, we used, I'm sure that we didn't use every coffee time, we tinkered with the rules. The rules as they finally came out were, if you have exactly three live, if you're empty or dead or whatever it is, and you have exactly three live neighbors, then something gets born there at the next time. If you are alive and you have two or three live neighbors, then you survive. I mentioned the birth rule first. To be born, you need exactly three live neighbors. To survive, you need either two or three.
So there were other iterations of the game. It could have been different.
Yeah, indeed. You know, it was different for quite a long time. We tinkered with these rules and finally came up with the ones I said. And they really seemed to have very nice properties. Namely, you didn't seem to be able to predict what would happen. And in the end, we succeeded in proving essentially anything could happen. These things could do any kind of computation you wanted to do. You could design configurations that rebuilt themselves or built more complicated machines than themselves, all sorts of things.
You had no computers when you were doing this early work?
No computers at all. After a time, there was a computer which had a screen, the PDP-8, and before it the PDP-7. I've forgotten what those PDPs, probably the DP is data processing or something. And then somebody immediately programmed the game of life for it. But the initial thinking was all done before then. I told Martin Gardner about it. He's the person who ran this mathematical games column in the Scientific American for 25 or 30 years. I thought it would interest people. I didn't think it would interest people, his readers, as much as it actually did. Well, first of all, his first column in the Scientific American was considerably before this, about hexaflexagons, and it got more reader mail than any previous article in the entire 100-and-something-year-old history of the magazine up to that time, and so the editors wanted him to write a monthly column. And he said to me that he was so broke that he just said yes before he knew whether he could write a monthly column. But anyway, he wrote that monthly column very successfully. And then when the Life game came up, guess what? That got more reader correspondence than anything in the entire history of the magazine, including this hexaflexagon column. From my point of view, though, it wasn't real mathematics. It was flattering to have so many readers interested in it and so on. But I personally didn't think all that much of it. But it's nice, you know. It's nice to have other people value something that, you know, I didn't really value in a way. Overall, now that I'm getting old, I'm really very pleased that this did happen. It's one incident in my mathematical life, and I shouldn't be so annoyed about it, and I'm trying not to be.
Has it been built upon? Is it one of the mathematics and the...
No, it's finished. I mean, that's another thing, really. You can build upon it in the following sense. You can study particular configurations. You can find alternative rules that still have the same properties and so on. But nothing, I think, that followed on it was just as interesting as the basic fact that this set of rules did exist, fairly simple, and have these astonishing properties, which weren't astonishing to me. Some configurations just die off. After a time, there's nothing left on the board. Some configurations seem to go on forever. Can you tell which of those is going to happen? Well, not really. If you put a configuration on the board and follow it and follow it and follow it, and after 1,000 moves, it hasn't died off, oh, well, maybe it's going to die off next move. There's no way of telling, no algorithmic way of telling whether a thing is definitely going to die off. Following it, you see, doesn't tell you. If you follow it for 1,000 moves and it hasn't died off yet, well, maybe it'll die off in 1,000,000 moves or 1,000,000,000 moves or 1,000,000,000,000 moves, whatever that is. And we do know, and this is not due to me, it's a theorem of mathematical logic dating from the 1930s, the halting problem, there's no way of absolutely guaranteeing to tell whether a thing will go on forever or fade away completely. That's one of the astonishing properties. You would think that if a thing is governed by very simple rules, there would be a very simple way of telling whether this very simple thing is a consequence of those very simple rules. But there isn't a way of telling.
Is the inventor of Game of Life, or people who've studied it deeply, have a deeper understanding? Like, can you look at a configuration and see something, or does it still baffle you too?
Well, I might be able to sort of recognise some little portion of it and say, oh, well, that's not going to have any effect. We can proceed as if that's not there because it's going to die in 23 moves anyway. But no, in general, no, you can't. I mean, this condition that, you know, you cannot tell is not a question of not being able to tell because you haven't got a big enough brain or something. It is an absolute condition, you know. It doesn't matter how clever you are. There's no guaranteed way of telling. Okay, I don't hate it.
But you don't love it?
No, I don't love it. I really don't. Yes, it made me happy is the only one of those different things. I sit in a corridor in the mathematics department in Princeton, and I think about things, and I imagine that the young graduate students there think, oh, this guy's a loony, he did something good once. And I don't care. I really don't care. I've been released from worrying about what other people think about me. I've said for 25 or 30 years, that the one thing I'd really like to know before I die is...